And hello everyone, welcome to a new episode. I'm so excited today. We are interviewing Dr. Amal, and she will share her story. She recently matched to UBC, and her story is very inspiring. I'm so happy, I'm so humbled today to be in her presence. And welcome, Dr. Amal.
Thank you. Thank you for the nice introduction.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you for volunteering to share your experience. I just want to disclaimer, Dr. Amal, she emailed me and she wanted to share her experience. So thank you so much, because like I've been having like a really hard time to find people who want to share their experience. And thank you so much for this. Yeah. All righty. So let's get started. So let's go from the beginning. When did you come to Canada and where did you med school before that?
Okay. So I did my medical school in Saudi Arabia. It's a university called Al-Faisal University, rising one right now, new, but very starting to progress quickly. And I came to Canada in February 2018 during my final year, what we call as internship, but would be counted as a final year med student in Canada to do internship electives. And at the time, I tried to get my hands on whatever electives I could do. So I did in internal medicine, research, orthopedic surgery, family medicine, lots of family medicine. And I tried to go to rural areas during my electives. And by December 2018, I was able to finish my internship, obtain my degree from within Canada. So I got it from back home, but I was staying in Canada when I got it. And after that, I started doing my exams, both of the USMLEs and the Canadian exams, and was also working on my immigration status, which took a while for me to eventually get the PR. Fast forward up until a few months ago, to April last year, that's when I got my PR. And all along, I was just doing a lot of community work and volunteering in healthcare related fields. And as soon as I got my PR, I had my QE1 scores, I was eligible to get a license in BC to basically deal with patients hands-on, history, gotcha, physical exam, and so on.
Okay, so your med school was in Saudi and your electives were there. So which year was that, mainly? From what period to, can you give me dates?
February 2018, yeah, was when I came to Canada.
And before that, everything was in Saudi and nothing here. You came here in February 18.
First time in my life. I have no family, no connections, zero. I don't know any IMGs who matched here. So yeah, fresh.
And you came here as a permanent resident or immigrants or
study permit.
You came here with study permit. So this is going to be very beneficial because many people always email me and ask me about requirements. One of the requirements to apply to the Canadian residency match is to be a permanent resident, but now we will talk more about it. So you came here with study permit. Okay, so you came in 2018 and your goal was to match into family medicine here in Canada.
Yes.
All righty. Yes. So what was the first step? You came here, what did you do? What did you know about the process? What did you do first?
So first thing was, before I came to Canada, everyone was saying generally for matching, you need letters of recommendation and you need through hands-on training, and that if you graduate, you won't be able to do that. So yeah, You'll be able to do it as a student. So I started asking, there were sponsored students from Saudi Arabia who would come for electives in Canada. So I started asking them about the AFMC and what's the application process. And then they just gave me the tip, the website. And I started searching every program, all the details, and tried to get my hands on applying. I literally applied to every potential elective I could get that would fulfill my internship requirements.
And sorry, what is the AFMC?
AFMC is the website where you can apply. It's a portal that is one for the whole of Canada for any electives that you would like to do in Canada, medical electives. Gotcha. So if you're a student, you didn't graduate, and you would like to get hands-on training, AFMC is the website to go to.
But if you graduated, you can't apply to do electives. Your path's going to be observership. And I think that's what you did.
I hope I knew before I came. And I remember my dad was telling me this. He's like, there is always an exception to the rule. And there was an exception. So BC license in here allows you what is equivalent to an elective experience after graduating. And that was an exception. But the only way for me to know was to come here and find out myself. So,
alrighty.
Yeah, that's new.
I didn't know about it.
So it is known if you just write on Google BC Observer's License. It used to be called Clinical Trainee License, but they're essentially the same thing. You function as a final year medical student, and you get to take history, physical exam, perform procedures under supervision. And if your supervisor trusts your expertise, they can give you more responsibilities and independency.
Gotcha. So you came here, you initially applied to this observership or...
For electives.
For electives, yes, through this website. So how was it? Tell me about it. Like, what did you do?
I had to, so it's provincial, just like CaRMS. You know how there's program descriptions? So you have to figure out every university, what are their unique requirements? And through the portal, it's very straightforward. Online, you can just upload your documents, whatever documents they ask for. Some of them require for criminal checks, some require certain photos, CV. You just read what they require and you submit it. And the duration that you would like. And it shows you there, like, what are the available specialties and what are the available durations or slots. If it doesn't work, you request another elective. So it's very easy to follow. Initially, it's overwhelming. But once you get the gist of it, it's very easy to follow. Everything can happen through the portal. The only issue was during COVID, the electives were...
Yes.
Yeah. But I think they might be coming back, or they already started. I'm not sure.
Gotcha. So you applied to one of these, and like, how was your experience? Tell me about it. Like,
it was amazing. I think that those electives gave me the best kickstart I could. It just put me ahead of the game from the beginning, because one, I got introduced to the system, mm-hmm. and two, I was able to get letters of recommendation from early on. Doctors were already offering me that all the way before I graduated. I got to know the residents, form connections. It's just, and also the fact that I did it in different provinces made me, it gave me an idea, where do I want to live? Where do I want to match? Where do I see? And I remember, so I did one I did two in Vancouver, one in Vancouver Island and one in Vancouver. And I did in Toronto. I did in Newfoundland, a rural city in Newfoundland. And I did in Nova Scotia, close to Halifax. So through experiencing these areas, okay, I could tell that it was very easy for me. By the time I graduated, I'm like, I know I want to match in Vancouver.
And for how long is this program like?
I did 1 month in each. One month.
Yeah. And they allowed you to go to Toronto and like different?
Amazing. Yeah, so you can do up to 8 weeks per university if there's an availability, up to 8 weeks.
And if you don't mind me asking you, like, is it paid or is it free? Like, what about the cost?
I have to pay for it. And your university is kind enough, or there's a certain, so our university promotes our students to go to the US, Canada, Australia, all of these countries. So they also assisted a bit in the process.
Gotcha. And just to emphasize that, like, by this point, when you were applying to it, you were already graduated. You were done.
The electives?
With medical school. You were a graduate physician when you are here in Canada, right?
No. So that's what I'm saying. We call it internship, but it's, you don't get your degree until you finish this 12-month internship. So technically,
gotcha.
You are a final year medical student. And this is always like a confusion. Yeah. So I was a medical student as per the North American definition.
Gotcha. And what about like people who already like established physician? Can they still enroll in this program or no?
AFMC, no.
No.
Yeah.
What about the Vancouver observership program?
Yes. That is by definition for post-grad, like after you graduate.
Gotcha. Okay. So you went on your journey and you did a couple of electives. What's then? Like, what did you do?
The elective specifically?
In general, yeah, right. If you can tell us about the electives, and then you can tell me, you can take me month by month about your journey. I would love to hear it. Yes.
Oh, okay. I will. I'll have to run it quickly just because there was a lot that was happening.
Yeah.
But I think in a nutshell, there was medical, surgical, family medicine, and I tried to sprinkle rural and research.
Gotcha.
So the internal medicine was in Toronto, downtown. And that was a really tough elective. It was my first one. So I was like, oh, okay, I better, you know, just speed up my learning process and adjust. And then I did family medicine in Vancouver Island. And then I did research also in Vancouver, and I did two rural, one family medicine, one orthopedic surgery. Those are were the ones in Nova Scotia and Newfoundland. And every learning experience was completely different, and it shaped the doctor that I'm going to be right now. Literally, like, they added just, there were skills and certain different levels of independency. Teaching hospital is not like a rural setting. In a rural setting, like, literally, I could be the first line. We had no residents. So when they call me, I am the first one who's going to be assisting in that C-section overnight or something like that. So I got a feel of what different programs could be like, because family medicine, you get exposed to every single specialty. We will have ortho, we will have trauma, we'll have obstetrics and so on. But I just knew that, okay, is this the kind of medicine I want to practice in the future and train, the setting I would train in?
Gotcha. Okay. So after your electives, what was your next step in your journey?
After graduating, get exams. So there were big monsters, NAC-OSCe and the QE1. And at the time, I wasn't very connected. I'm very introverted. And I ended up doing my NAC-OSCe alone, without any practice partners, without anything. And in like one or 2 months prep. And I wasn't, so at the time, I did my USMLE step one first, and then I did my NAC-OSCe. And because of how rigorous the match process is, and what people were telling me about how difficult it is, like CaRMS, and my other friends were matching everywhere else, I was not feeling good. So even my setting was really, I was not in the best place mentally. So I just went to the exam. I had no idea. I'm like, God, please help me. Like, I don't know. I passed, but I knew I could do better. So 1 year later, 1 year and a half, I repeated the NAC-OSCe.
Okay.
Just, yeah.
And when you say like my friends were matching in other places, like you mean places like the US, right?
US.
I just want to emphasize on that, because yes. I had very similar experience when I came here, like having many friends in the US, and like always the grass is greener on the other side, right? So I always hear, oh, everyone's matching, everyone like, and me like listening to people here, like even like I talked to physicians and they told me, go to the US, like your chances are almost impossible. In Canada, it's like 2%, you know, like all that. Yeah. Thank you.
I've heard it, Ollie.
Yes. Okay. So we tried the NAC-OSCe the first time and no partners. So we did it again in next year. After the OSCe, you realized how the exam was, like, what did you say to yourself?
Honestly, the exam was as I expected. I just needed more practice. So there was a lot of like how you use your body language, your communication skills. It was more than just knowledge. To me, that how was the NAC-OSCe felt like that. So and it was very family medicine oriented. So you have to be a generalist in your approach. Otherwise, I think the NAC-OSCe is very manageable, like in my opinion. It's the QE1 that was a little different. You have to just understand the nature of the. So I did like the QE1 and the CK, for instance, and they test the same knowledge, but the way they ask the questions and the answer that they're looking for is completely different. And the QE, the QE1 took me, my university is known, they are US-based curriculum. So I had to re-engineer my way of thinking to the the QE1.
So tell me, how did you prepare? Okay, so the OSCe, we need like partners, we need people to train with.
Yes.
Okay, so that when it comes to the OSCe, and like, it's just like a tip for everyone who's like watching us, like, we're not trying to promote to any company or whatever, like, but OSCe, it's about partners. Train with many people as you can, with people at your level, less than you, above you, better than you, worse than you. Train. It's all about physical and body language. That's it. Okay, so tell me about your QE1 then. What did you use to, like, for as a study resource? How long? Did you take any of those exams that are on the MCC website? So tell me about everything.
Good. And so my QE1 study plan was very different than everyone else. I probably, this is going to be the first time you hear this way, but I, you know, online med ed, it's like, yeah, a website with free video. Yeah, so I you know, the QO1 covers all of medicine, and I wanted to recap that because every month you're just switching to a different specialty and you start like losing the information from the previous one. So I just watched, got his videos and watched every system on double speed. And then I would do the Canada QBank. Gotcha. Literally, this is in a nutshell everything I have done in for this exam, and I studied for 3 months. But it's not just as simple as that. It was my study method. How did I extract the information? So before studying, a lot of the work, my homework was before studying, I started asking everyone who passed with good scores, what do you think were more the most important subjects in QE1? And what are your biggest tips? And there was a big feedback regarding public health and psychiatry. So I like the concept of 80-20 rule. I want to dedicate 80% of my effort in that 20% that's going to count like for the for most of the effort is going to give me 80% of the results. So I spent a lot of time on public health and ethics. Almost half of my study prep was on that. So what I would do is, because there aren't good references regarding that, it's unique to Canada, and Toronto notes is so dry. So I could not get it to process like in my mind. So I studied through the QBank. I organized by topic, the questions by topic, and I would solve, I tried to get 100 to 300 questions per day just because I knew that speed is important for the exam. So I would start my morning 7 a.m. Initially it was 100 questions, but I built up to 300. So 300 questions per day. And then I would read the explanations and take notes from the explanation in Canada QBank. And I created an entire notebook just out of the explanations in Canada QBank. And I was learning through my mistakes. So by that time, when I went to Toronto Notes, everything made perfect sense because I had already registered it very well in my mind. And I also used the CMPA website. Amazing resource. It was CMPA.
Interesting.
Huh?
Interesting. I mean, I never heard about this. Okay.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So a CMPA website was amazing, and it had exams. Like it had sample tests that were very much, very helpful for the real thing and very resembling of the actual, you know, exam. So this was public health. And then I did psych. That's when I started with online med-ed, because online med-ed doesn't have Canadian public health. So I would watch his videos, solve the questions, extract the notes. I use an iPad, so it's smart. I can like easily move the notes around, and I created like really good notes. Did the same for all the systems except internal medicine. I did not solve a single question of internal medicine from Canada QBank. I skipped that. If you notice, it's like 80% of the questions in the QBank. And I had 3 months. And from the feedback I got at the time, I don't know if it's different right now, is that internal medicine is not that high yield. Family medicine is general, but not internal. So I skipped it. I skipped it in Canada QBank. I only did it from online med-ed to review the information. We all know internal medicine. We've been exposed. Like it's just the general topics. And that's it. And you mentioned the exam. So I did the MCC exam. That's for, there is an expensive exam. That's like a full thing with CDM and MCQs. It's, I don't know, like 500. It's really expensive.
Yeah, on the MCC website, you mean?
Yeah, during that time, because of COVID, they actually reduced the price. So I did that. Again, I'm US, like I'm used to the US MLEs, you know, they have MBMEs. So I wanted to find something similar. So I took that exam 10 days, maybe 1 week before my actual thing. And I wanted to score more than 70%. And I did. And I'm like, okay, I think I'm ready for the test. I won't change the date. And I just went in. Yeah.
Amazing. Amazing. Oh my God. Thank you so much for sharing those tips. Like, yeah, I think this is going to be great studying tips for the MCC QE, because like also I've been struggling to find people who passed the exam and I scored high and like they were able to match. So please be everyone out there who is listening to this. If you have a great experience about the MCC QE, please let me know, email me, and we can like set up an interview and talk about it. Thank you so much. This is the first time someone like share like details about preparing for an exam like this.
Okay.
So we did the MCC QE. What's next? You took the exam and that was like 2019, I assume?
No, that was actually 2020, I think. 2020. So this was spread out over, because I knew my PR was not coming out. So I was like doing volunteering community, like doing other things, and then doing an exam. Okay. But it was back to back with the CK.
Okay. With the CK too. So you were taking the American exams with the Canadian exams.
Yes.
Good job. I did the same thing. I highly recommended it. I think like the American exams make the Canadian exams much look easier, let's say. But I think the public health part of the CMPA, it's something unique in your experience. Okay. So we did the Q exam. What about the IELTS? Or like which type of language?
Good question. So I had the IELTS from when I, I studied in international schools back in Saudi. And that means that your English is the primary language that's being taught throughout school. And Arabic is like, lessons for Arabic language, but that's it. But math, science, everything is in English. And I think that made it easier for me. So sometimes when I want to give tips, I feel like it's unfair to the person in front of me if they learned English as an adult or like after 18 years of age or so. So IELTS was not a...
Okay.
No, I took it.
You took IELTS, but...
But it was not a challenge for me. I can share my study plan, but it will apply to the people that are on the same page as I am, if that makes any sense.
Sure. Yeah, go ahead.
I think for that exam, even if you're a native speaker, writing is the challenge. Everyone I know is struggling with that section particularly. And what I did for writing is I read... Some are online or in their books, they have examples of people who scored high in the past. So I would just read that. I would practice, take a certain excerpt, and I start writing my, whatever passage. And then I would look at people who scored high and see what did they do different. What language did they use? What grammar, extra grammar? So I would just take tips from that. I read a lot online and then I would apply it. So I think that was the main thing. The main struggle was the writing section, and I passed with a 7, like right at the that's the minimum they require. But otherwise, I think I'm not in the best place to comment about IELTS.
It's okay. Fair enough. It's still like useful. I'm sure someone will benefit from that info. Okay. So the OSCE QE1 IELTS. What other exams did you take?
Step 1 and Step 2 CK. Okay. And then the assessments, like the bunch of assessments, the Casper, CAP.
Exactly. So take me through this one.
Oh gosh. So I'm going to compare Casper and CAP. I think there is some resemblance between the two. So Casper is a written exam that is required for, I believe this year, Dalhousie did not require it, but in the past Dalhousie required it, Saskatchewan and Manitoba. And then CAP, Clinical Assessment Program, is unique to UBC. And it's very important in the application. So CASPER is basically, they're both ethical scenarios. There are dilemmas. And they start asking you questions. CASPER, you have to type your questions. So if you're a slow typer, which was my case, I got affected negatively by that. But if you're good with this, like speaking, then CAP is going to be the good one. So CAP is very similar to CASPER, but you will be speaking. And CASPER tests you on day-to-day kind of things. They don't have to be medical at all. But CAP is very medical. Like they bring you ethical dilemmas that you would experience in the hospital, in the clinic setting as a physician. So in that sense, it's a little bit more challenging. And I practiced, it's the same thing. I just practiced questions and I knew exactly what CASPER wanted. I knew what I wanted to say. I was just slow in putting it down. So my score was meh, like it was not that great. But my score in CAP, because I like to talk, was actually good. And I think in both, this could take like an hour on its own, but I will just say one thing. They don't care about your opinion. They care about you seeing all sides of the story, being neutral and seeing all sides of the story and being creative and innovative and coming with solutions. So I know people who are genius and they are empathetic and everything, but they were very strong in their opinions. They did not score well in these exams because that's not what they're looking for. So if I give you an ethical dilemma, I don't want you to take a side. I want you to tell me all the possible stories and all the possible, like consider everyone involved in this dilemma their position and how we can come up with a solution that serves all the parties involved, something that's middle ground that suits everyone and being diplomatic in a way.
Gotcha. And what resources did you use for those exams?
For CASPER, I used BMO book, not the sessions, just the book. They always have like some discounts and a disclaimer, we're not endorsed by any of these programs, but I found the book to be straightforward, short, and it gets the point through. And then online, you'd find a lot of forms and PDFs by universities, by medical schools, of sample cases. So I would use those from UBC, University of Alberta, from many places, and the CASPER and CAP overlap. So you could kind of use the same cases, and I would just practice. I actually started taking lessons for typing to increase my typing speed right before CASPER, because I knew that was my limitation. For CAP, it's pretty much the same. And there's also a YouTube channel by UBC that has very nice scenarios that are similar to CAP. It's for pre-med, but they are very, very resembling. So again, I think the answer is practice. You could find whatever resources, but eventually you have to do, like for CAP, I did ton of practice. And I knew, because I wanted to match in UBC, so the effort I put into CAP was different than the one in CASPER. And I was just like fighting for my life. And I recorded myself in videos, watched these videos, as cringy as that was. Took feedback from people who were quote unquote better than me, worse than me, better English, worse English, it doesn't matter. I had people who would tell me like, oh no, let's practice with each other, we're at the same level. And I'm like, no, I'm going to practice with anyone and everyone. And I'm glad that you mentioned that. Everyone has something to add. Everyone has some valuable feedback. And even if someone is, again, quote unquote, I don't like to say that, but let's say they're like behind in a sense, if you give them feedback, you're learning through that process.
I agree. Thank you so much for that. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. So yeah, I just practiced like leading up to the day of CAP. I just paused in the final hours because I'm like, okay, I need to calm my nerves down. But it was a ton of practice. And residents are actually a valuable feedback. If you can get in touch with residents in the program, especially their IMG, they could give very valuable feedback. And I was lucky to have that with me as well, for CAP particularly.
Wow, inspiring and detailed.
I feel like I've been talking for a long, and then I'm like, okay.
No, I love it. You're talking, yeah. No, not at all. Like, those are the things that the people who listen to us, like, they want to hear. They want details, right? Like, when I came here 5 years ago, like, no one told me about the details. No one told me what to do. I just, like, I had a friend who matched the year before me, and I just did whatever he did. But it was so stressful. So thank you so much. Okay, so... exams, are there anything we are missing? Is there anything that you want to cover in your experience?
I think these were the main ones. Like, I haven't done any other assessments yet, no.
Okay, so we talked about the observership or electives, we talked about the exams. What about the third cornerstone, research?
Oh, okay. So this is for everyone out there. You could have a weak link in your application and still match. That was my weak link. Research was, and every time I'm talking to someone, I was giving like a session a few days ago, and that was the same thing. They're like, you didn't say a single word about research. Like, I thought you guys won't notice and we'll just pass by. So research is not my strength area. I wouldn't say I didn't have anything. I had a page in my CV that was about research, but my personal interest is in leadership positions. I like to come up with ideas and then bring a team, and they would do the technical part of research just because they're better than I am in that. So I was part of big research projects in my university, and as well after graduating. The first one was, I was a coordinator of medical education research that comes out of our university. So we have all the batches, like around 500 students. We would recruit them, put them into teams, assign them faculty, and I would do literature review to see what is the publications out there regarding medical education, what's the most up-to-date thing, and give ideas to the teams so that they can start their own projects. And I had one of my own, but I was not like rigorous on publishing more than initiating and getting people to hold, like carry the ball and continue with it. After graduating, before graduating, I did an elective in research. That was in St. Paul's Hospital here in Vancouver, and it was regarding HIV, hepatitis B and C, and the high-risk populations that would get it. And it was at that time that it clicked in my mind that this is a population I would like to work with in the future, and I would like to do more. So it was only 1 month. It was amazing. I learned a lot, but I felt like I need to come back and do more to this community. I don't know if you know, but in Vancouver, we have a huge homeless community. We have an opioid crisis, and they really need medical attention and reducing barriers to healthcare. So after graduating, I came back, started working with an infectious disease specialist, and we were going down on the streets doing, so I was also two programs. I was doing volunteering community work where we would give them food, we would train them on naloxone, we would.
Okay. So let's just hold it there. So So research, we talked about it just to create like a difference. And I just want to say something like disclaimer, like I didn't have any research experience when I managed to, like, everyone knows my story out there. Like I did my med school in Syria, in Aleppo. And it was like, at that time it was war. So I didn't have like lots of research. I had like a couple of lines here and there, but nothing crazy. I matched. There are people who I interviewed had lots of research. So again, research can make your application, but it doesn't break it to that high degree. If you don't have it, please don't get don't get discouraged. Alrighty.
So, unless it's a specialty.
Alrighty. So you were talking about volunteering, and sorry to cut you there. So
no, that's okay.
Tell me what this. Now we're going to talk about like volunteering and community experience. Tell me about it.
I would say this was the biggest part of my application that was very prominent and UBC and BC based. So I'm glad that you mentioned this. So I did a lot of, let's see, where did I start? So I did work with the homeless population, and I did work with refugees. And it was all like humanitarian aid based. And there was also a project that I was doing where we would collect medical supplies, leftover medical supplies that don't fulfill the criteria in Canada, but would be very valuable in countries that have war, like Syria, like Yemen, like many countries, Ukraine right now, we just sent there one. So so there were these three big categories. The medical aid, that's what we have done with refugees. I started as an interpreter, and then I started working as a medical office assistant in a refugee clinic. And through that job, I was able to do a lot when it comes to catering to the services, even though it's a job, but I considered it and I felt like it was community work, especially being a native Arabic speaker. I can communicate with many of those refugees on a personal level, and I can figure out what are their unique needs and connect them to the government programs or services that could help them, and community services and so on. And then there was the homeless population. It started out as a group of people who are, we rented a place in downtown Vancouver and we were handing out food. Simple as that. Slowly we developed on-site a chiropractor clinic to manage their pain. And then we had a group who started naloxone training. And then we had a group of a social worker who was leading other projects that had to do with mental health. And then I connected, and that's very important when it comes to networking. I was connected to a doctor who was doing an outreach health fair, where he would do research. So what I mean is they go out, they try to find in a public space, and they try to find high-risk population, do point of care testing for HIV and Hep C screening. And we get approval from them. If they accept, we can start continuing care for them if they test positive. We try to find what are the team members they're working with, and the infectious disease specialist can offer them continuous care. So that was, I was not part of that. They were separate, and they found out about us, and they're like, okay, we have a doctor on site. That was me. So I started working with him, took care of like leading that project. And that was unfortunately right before COVID. So it was a very short time that eventually we had many restrictions, but it was still very valuable. And then we started doing this, and I was able to get consent with my team, get consent from these patients and continue care. So it started from food, and it ended up with actually accessibility to healthcare and providing care to these patients. And I would say that kind of community work And volunteering was really valuable for my application and for the interviews that I've gotten. And it definitely stands out for like community, if you're you know, planning to apply to BC, to Saskatchewan, places that where they have a lot of marginalized populations that they're catering to, it is very important in your application. And I don't know if you agree with me on this or not, but we were told that volunteering is not, it's the weakest link in your CV. It's not the, you know, it goes like from hands-on training, observership, research, observership, and then the last thing is volunteering. And I think you could very much turn it into the most powerful part of your application that if you were not to have any hands-on training, and I know people who have done it, if you don't have any hands-on training, but you have a powerful, impressive, and not just impressive, like you really served the community in a way that someone else didn't. You initiated something that really filled a gap. This could be the strongest part of your application, and it could make up for so much. Not, I wouldn't even say make up. It would actually be the reason some people would choose you in their program. And I know people who matched through that. And I know people who got reference letters. I don't know for internal medicine if it's the same, but for family medicine, I'm aware of people who got reference letters from such experiences and matched. So it was not, they had one or two that were hands-on, clinical, but then the last one or one or two were not clinical and they matched. And I know these people personally, so I'm not making this up. So do not underestimate what you can do through volunteer work, especially if it's something you're passionate about. You're just going to go all the way in into it.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think like there is no such thing as like a weak link or a strong link. It's all like the entire package. Of course, like your scores will open much doors to you, like for you when compared to volunteering, but that doesn't mean you should not do volunteering. If you have time, go for it. I just want to emphasize on one thing, like in one of my interviews, like Dr. Hamid, he was doing urology at the University of Ottawa. And actually the story, how I met him is it's through, I was volunteering at the hospital here at the General Hospital in Ottawa. I used to go every Thursday from 6 to 10 and just like guide patients, put them in the wheelchair. That's what I found at that time. And I'm so happy I did it. I just use also like to walk around. And if I see any residents or doctors, I would just ask him, do you know any IMGs who matched? And like from one person to another person, it wasn't easy. Just like approaching someone and asking about like IMG while they are doing their busy work. So they introduced me to him actually. And then like, he said, okay, I will meet you. And like, he gave me some tips and tricks. And then like, now we are friends. Like, and the first time I met him when I was volunteering. So there is no, I highly emphasize on what you say. You never know what doors it will open to you. You can show interest. It was something I talked about in my interviews at the University of Ottawa, like saying, okay, like I volunteer here. I want to give back to the community. Like Ottawa has its own place in my heart because like, it's the first city I arrived to. And I really love the community here. So I agree with you. Yes, I completely agree with you. So if you have the time, go for it. And you never know what doors it will open.
And if it's the option you have, that's what I'm, so some people like got restricted because, for example, let's say you didn't score well in your K1 and you can't repeat it. And you're in a place where you only have the option of observership and you can't do hands-on training. And you see a volunteer opportunity, take it. Like if it's something you're passionate about, take it and take it all the way till the end. Take initiative, make it something bigger. And as you mentioned, like then it becomes so yeah. People like, oh no, it's just volunteering. No, it's not just volunteering. It could be more if you choose to.
If you don't mind me asking you, like, how did you find the opportunity of volunteering? Like, what did you search in Google? What did you type? Or like someone told you about it?
Yeah, no. As I think I mentioned earlier, I'm an introvert. I'm not very social. People think I am. I'm not. I'm very, very shy. So I just remember at the time when I said I was mentally not in a good place. You know, being a Muslim, I go to the place where we worship. So I went to the mosque, tried to connect to with people there. And that food, giving food in downtown was through that mosque. I was going there regularly, made friends, connected with people. And then they're like, okay, we have this project that's starting on this day. Would you like to come out with us and we'll be giving food? It was just as simple as that. And I went there. I went there second day, third day. And they're like, okay, would you take this coordinator position, something like that? I'm like, okay. And then it was just step by step. And then we would meet and come in meetings and I would give ideas. So it's very natural. Like, I don't know. It's you just have to be on the lookout for passing chances. It's happening all the time. But if you're just in your own head, you won't notice it. Same applies for the medical aid. I had a good friend. I'm the equipment that we would send to other countries. I had a good friend and she's in public health. And I told her, like, I would really like to do something where I would help others. Do you know of any other opportunity? It's just like, no, I don't have any. 6 months later, she messages me. I'm like, okay, I'll come. Again, I was just a volunteer. And then it became more. They're like, okay, you're a doctor. You could tell us about what are the essential medical supplies that we need to use and what aren't. So I have some knowledge that I could tell them. There are things that we can't send, you know, we need to be picky. So yeah. That, and then it just built up.
Amazing. Okay, so we covered exams, volunteering, research. What else did you do to make your application strong? Like, what would you tell people specifically about UBC?
UBC, okay, yes. I would say understand the community that you will be serving, especially if you're applying for family medicine. It's all about the population that you will be treating. So, and that was, my application was screaming BC, literally. So, because if you look, like, the projects that I was doing, the volunteer work, the electives, the hands-on, the license, I didn't mention. So I did that license in family medicine and pediatrics. And they were all here in Lower Mainland in Surrey. Just, you don't have to be in BC, but you have to understand the community so that your CV and your personal letter shows that you know what is the population that you'll be treating, and address it clearly. So I was saying, you know, I know I'm going to, I want to serve this population and I want to promote this kind of health. Like I mentioned it clearly, what I want to do, what I'm doing right now, what I will be as a resident and what I will be filling in the future so that you are an asset. You're not begging to get in. No, your addition is going to be an addition to the program and you'll make this program better. And does that make any sense?
It makes lots of sense. Exactly. You are trying to say, like, you have something to offer, like you have skills to sell when it comes to the application process, which we'll talk about. Sorry, go
ahead. And in order to do that, you have to know what you're getting yourself into. So you could try to reach out to residents and ask them, or family doctors. Just figure out a way online. We have such an easy life with being able to find people on LinkedIn or whatever. Do your research and know, even the programs in BC are different. There are rural programs like up north and there is a downtown. So see what you're interested in and just search that, research it very well. Another thing, not just for BC, for all the programs, read carefully the program description. I think UBC is one of the most transparent, like they're clear, they're more clear than other programs when it comes to what they need. And I remember in the program description at the bottom, there was an other section. So CaRMS puts the usual requirements and they just say yes or no. And then there's an other section. UBC took out the time to mention 4 or 5 points that they care about. And that was the gist of my whole application and my interview process. And a big one was advocacy and resilience. So that's why my community work and being an IMG, we're resilient by default. Like, we have to be resilient to be able to get to apply to CaRMS. You're already proven yourself. And advocacy. So they really care about the volunteer and community work. What do you add to the community you are in outside of medicine? Like, it's not just medical. They actually want to know what you do as a, even if it's like cooking or so. Oh, and my personal letter. So I during COVID, that's when I found out about weightlifting, heavy weightlifting, and COVID shutdown happens. And I need to strength train. Like, I became hooked. I need to do it. So I started going out in the parks. We have a very nice, it's a very beautiful weather. It's a nature. So I would go out in the parks and find monkey bars, pull-up bars, any dip bars, anything I could get my hands on, train. And then I would share it online. And then there was a community, especially women, when they see like a young female hijabi, you know, like she's doing that, so they're like, okay, if she can do it, I can do it. Yeah. So I mentioned
that for you. This is like amazing.
Yeah, so I mentioned that in my personal letter. That's advocacy. I was advocating for, you know, physical health for women. And I mentioned it in my letter and I mentioned it in my interview. It makes a difference. Like these things, don't think that it's just medicine. Yeah, that's what I would say.
Wow, good for you. I'm also very big advocate for like exercise training. If people like you follow me on Instagram, you're gonna see me every day.
I've seen it. Yeah.
Every single day, pre-call, post-call, on-call, every day. Like it's just like
same. You know, here it's I'm fasting for Ramadan, and you know, like okay. I can work out when I'm fasting, but I'm like I want to do a good workout, so I do it after suhoor, like at 5 a.m. I'm heading out because that's the last, when I have the last meal, exactly, and I can have caffeine. So I'm like, no excuses if the whole world stands in front of me. I'm still going to get
all on Instagram. Good for you. Yeah. Amazing job. Wow, this is inspiring. Yeah, like I only thought about it after resume. Good for you. Like you thought about it even at this stage. Amazing. Okay, so we covered the specifics of UBC. Is there anything else that you want to talk about UBC?
For UBC, I think if you have a good CAP score, you're setting yourself off. That's like if I would, I know there are many things and it's inspiring and everything, but if you have a score in the top one or like the first or second percentile in CAP, you're setting yourself up very well. If you're a BC resident, it's better because we have 50% of the spots and then 50% for non-BC and community and volunteer. That's in a nutshell. Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay. So let's come now, I think, to the interviews, right? In those two years, we worked on the application, we wrote the exams, we did the research, we did the community work, we got letters of reference, and now we were heading toward the CaRMS and interviews. So tell me about this process. How was it? What did you do? How was your approach? How did you feel everything? Tell me details.
Okay. So I went, people get confused about this. I went through the match technically 3 times. So last year's first iteration, second iteration, and this year. Interviews in each one of them. Wow. So last year, April 27 was when I got my PR. And that was after the last interview of the second iteration. So I was... That CaRMS match, I was not eligible to apply. And me being myself, I did not take that for an answer. So I was supposed to get my PR 1 to 2 months before the CaRMS, and I was preparing to apply for it. COVID, I was during my IELTS exam, the immigration office called me, my phone was off. Wow. I emailed them, your application is deferred to, I don't know, 4 months or something. That was the most devastating news I have ever got in my life. And I, UBC is, they do not play around with if you don't have your PR, you're not eligible, full stop. In Ontario, there are exceptions. In other provinces, you could email them. UBC does not. So UBC was out of the picture. And I wanted to match in BC. So I emailed the member of parliament. I'm like, please, I need my PR. I'm going to miss my application. They try, they expedite. It still doesn't come in time. So I started emailing CaRMS in the programs. And this is what I want to tell people. You'd never know what chances you could create out of nothing. Just do not live in doubt. Email, contact them, call them, like figure out. You might find a way that's no one else has found about. So I literally started like emailing them. And I'm like, I have a proof that it's pending and it's going to come out. Can I apply, please? And they got it through. I don't know if all the programs were accepting it or not. And CaRMS, like it doesn't show if they rejected based on what reason. But I knew that Ottawa and Western, they do accept if you have a pending application and you didn't officially, they accept it. So I applied all over and got interview for Dalhousie. Dalhousie interview is very similar to the CAP. It's ethical scenarios and you have to talk about it. And I got Ontario, that's in the first iteration. Second iteration, I got Ottawa. Again, like so Ottawa, they had 2 unfilled spots and I got Saskatchewan. I wasn't ready. I will be honest, I wasn't ready and I didn't know because of the PR and I was right out of the CK and the QE1. I'm just fighting, but I don't have a clear plan regarding what I want to do. And one thing I would say about interviews, you got to know why they're asking a certain question. you have to know what's the intention so that your answer is tailored towards that intention. So I went into these interviews, my natural self, and that's okay. People say, be yourself. Of course, be yourself, but still have a plan regarding what you want to say. But I was just saying things without, it could be a very nice answer, but it doesn't tick the boxes. So I got through that, did a match. And fast forward this year, I have the PR, I have my BC license, and I had already thought about the interview. Like one of the reasons I fought to go through the match, I'm like, the worst case scenario is I'm going to learn something, anything. I'm just going to get through the interviews. And that is a learning experience on its own. So, and that was the case. I went through the process and I'm like, okay, I need to understand, why are they asking these questions? So I asked around residents, researched, and then I tried to come up with all the common questions that are asked in interviews and group them into themes, categories, basically. So if like you could ask in interviews, they could ask 10 different questions, but they're asking the same thing. So I tried to lump it. And then I started brainstorming stories from my experience. Especially the most difficult is patient stories. So I started brainstorming stories and how do they fill this theme, typed it down, started practicing, getting feedback, changing it, practicing, getting feedback. And I kept on doing that nonstop for like 2-3 months. At the end, I was like doing many hours per day with people, just practicing with different people. And I was basically perfecting my answers. By the time I was doing the interview, I was very comfortable. The anxiety was reduced. And I knew exactly what they were asking. I think that's the difference between me last year. If you're questioning yourself, I always say, if you didn't match, and that's okay, you need to diagnose. You need to narrow the diagnosis regarding why you didn't match. Is it your CV or is it? So I knew I got the interviews. I knew it's not in the previous part. I knew it's something I said. So my that was my diagnosis, and my treatment was working on my answers. So yeah, I highly recommend that you take the time to write down your unique stories about resilience, stories about a patient that was difficult, quote unquote difficult. I don't think there's any patient that is actually difficult. Just write them down, and then even you might even change the stories, but just get yourself to do this homework and this brainstorming session. And then edit, practice, keep doing it until leading up to the interview.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think like, I always tell people, I've been interviewing people, helping people with their interview is one of my passions. For the last 3.5 years, I've been doing this. And as you said, I usually group them into 4 categories, like know yourself, know your program, know your specialty, and questions about tell me about the time. So that's my general approach. And that's how I usually help tell people, like there are 200 questions out there. You can search hundreds, but eventually those questions going to boil down into one of those categories. They will ask you the same question in a different way. And practice, it's very important. Like I always tell people also, like treat the interview as you treat the OSCE exam. You didn't go to the OSCE exam, you as a being physician, and like, oh yeah, I'm a good physician. No, that's not how it works. Like there is techniques of answering the question. And we as a human beings enjoy to listen to stories, right? So like try to learn the art of telling a story. Unfortunately, mm-hmm. It's something that we are not born with, but we can learn it. Like you can practice it by daily basis, as you said. Like that's what I did also for my interviews. Like I practice on daily basis. I had a great partner to practice with. If she's listening to us, thank you so much, by the way. So I just practice. I treat it as the OSCE exam, and I think it should be treated that way. And that doesn't mean that the interview is like it's an artificial and your questions should be out of nowhere. That's not it. No,
you don't lose yourself through the process. Yeah.
You know how to be organized. You learn how to tell a story that eventually will make sense. And the third thing that you mentioned, the last thing, sorry, you mentioned the anxiety. Yes, anxiety is true. And the only way to overcome the anxiety is by practicing. And it can happen to all of us. For me, I'm an extrovert. I've been in my high school and like in my university, I was on the stage. I had many, many hobbies. I was under like camera lights, but despite that, the interview made me nervous. So yeah. All right. So you went through lots of interviews, amazing. And eventually you achieved your goal. Okay. Is there anything else in your story that you want to cover today?
Yeah, definitely. It's just the waiting time. I graduated into a new year, 2019, leading up to now 2022. Those 3 years passed for me, like felt like they were painful and slow in the beginning. And I think for some IMGs, it's even longer. It's even harder. So during COVID time, I eventually had to sit with myself and I'm like, I cannot live with these emotions, with this negative feeling. That's not who I am. And I had to basically reassess my ideas about myself. Like, how do I view myself and this match process? It is very important to separate your value, your self-value, from the result of the match. That is going to make a huge like difference in how you look at things. You have always been valuable. You have been a hard worker. Maybe leading up to the match, if you're applying by the match, you've gone through exams, you've gone through interviews, you've gone through life events that no one knows about that could be unique to you. And I had like off my own. These were successes. But I was putting my value in the fact that I couldn't match or I didn't apply to the match or that my friends have reached somewhere. So I think it is once I made that switch, I started enjoying myself, appreciating myself more, being kinder, the way I am kind to other people. I'm like, people say, okay, you're so like empathetic. And I'm like, I'm not that empathetic towards myself, but I'm living with my own body the whole time. This is not right. So I started treating myself the way I treat others, where I'm like, if things don't go the way I want, I'm being kind. I try to see the big picture. When I do something good, I have a party. Like, I swear to God, sometimes I get myself a cake. I get myself a gift. I go out on my own. Just enjoy the process and appreciate yourself and this body and this mind that you have been given. It's a gift. Many people might be really looking up to you and you're thinking of yourself in a small way. So separate the two. And that means when you match, that means you're not superior to others. When people right now are reaching to me, you're like, oh, you matched. Hello, doctor. And I'm like, I think I'm just the same person 3 months ago. It's just there is a title that is added to my like a certificate, but nothing really changed. I'm still the same person.
Amazing. Thank you so much for sharing that too. Yeah, I think as an IMG, we went through a lot. We go through a lot until we match. And being nice to yourself, it's also one of the important, like I would say the same thing. I'm guilty of the same mistake. I'm always like, I just like remind myself, like if one of my friends did not match, I won't go and tell them, oh, like, what did you do? You messed up. No, I would try to make them feel good about myself. But if it happens to me, I would beat up myself. I think this is very important. Thank you so much for sharing. This is something personal. Like, this is the first time someone like shares on the channel. Thank you so much for it. Yes, I highly and completely agree with that. Yeah.
All right.
All righty. Any last tips and tricks? Any last words for people who are listening?
I think by now I've said it all, or at least what I wanted to say. I would just say, just be kind to yourself, and your value is not connected. And just being a person of faith, I really believe that all of us have a timeline in our life, things that will happen at a certain time. No matter what we do, it's the timeline and the story is going to take, it's going to be the way it is. So now I just live in the moment. I'm like, okay, what happened was meant to happen, what didn't, but I just want to be at peace with myself that I did my best. You know, there's a post or like I saw it on Instagram where it says like, what do you do for a living? And the answer is like, I do my best. I do my best for a living.
Exactly. Always do your best. Do whatever you can and things happen. And I believe things happen for a reason.
Yeah. That's all. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Again, thank you so much. Like, thank you. First, thank you for stepping up and emailing me for sharing your story. This is going to help hundreds and hundreds of, if not thousands of people. Thank you so much for sharing all these details. Sometimes like people don't feel comfortable. And thank you so much for being an introvert and willing to be under the spotlight and behind the camera and telling your story. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.